Good morning, friends. We just have a few more minutes before our service begins. And we invite you to begin to pray and seek the Lord. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. You can pull out your Bible and start reading a psalm or a passage that you're in right now. You're welcome to come up to the front and pray and worship. But let's begin to set the atmosphere of worship in this place. Father of glory, we pray that you would give us the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Jesus, that the eyes of our hearts would be enlightened, that we may know what is the hope of your calling, what are the glorious riches of your inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceedingly great power that works towards us as we believe in you. Open our eyes. Open our eyes to see you, Jesus. Let's all stand to worship together. We serve an awesome God. Lord, reveal yourself to us today and help us respond to you with overflowing praise. Yeah, come on, let's start. Let's start by giving him a hand clap of praise. Let's start because he's awesome. Awesome God. Let love A love so bold to see a revolution somehow.
It's rising up.
Sense that the Lord is wanting to restore our song. He wants to restore our song, and for some that might be strange. You might think, I'm not a singer. I don't have songs. Each of us has a song in our heart. It's our joy, you know? It's our praise that we release to the Lord. That's your song. It's who you are. And I've sensed that the Lord wants to restore our song this morning. And if you know that you need Him to renew your song, I want to invite you to come to the front and just receive ministry, receive from the Lord today. And if you just need a touch from God today, that's it. I just need a touch from God. I just need an encounter with God. Whatever it is, whether it's physical, emotional, or you're just hungry, you want more, I want to invite you to the front. So come on up. You know the Lord just needs to restore that song in you, or you just want a touch from God. Come on up to the front. Let's worship Him together. Let Him pour out on us. Minister to us.
Restore my strength, Jesus. You restore.
Ministry from one of our ministry team members, just go ahead and put your hand up. Keep your hand up until somebody comes and prays for you. Thank you, Lord. The rest of us, let's continue to worship, minister to the Lord, and pray for those who are gathered in the front. Pray for the pouring out of the Spirit. Or if you're in your seat and you just want somebody next to you to pray for you, go ahead and pray for one another. Now and loose that song of the Lord that's in us. If you pray in tongues, you can go ahead and sing in tongues. Otherwise, you can sing in English, or you can just sing out from your heart. You can take out your Bible and read and sing from a psalm. There's so many ways to sing to the Lord from our hearts. So right now, let's all lift our voices. Oh, yeah. Every voice in this place, lift it up to the Lord. The new song, the restored song, the song of joy. You are my strength, you are my song. Yeah. Just step out in faith, lift your voice to the Lord. He's gonna do something as we open our mouths. Just sing, Jesus, I love you, Lord, I love you, Lord. Oh, let's sing, hallelujah. The Lord for what he's doing in our midst today. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. My hope is built on nothing less. Hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus. Let's sing that again. Hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne. Just stand before Him right now.
His power and glory evermore.
proclaim your majesty, Lord.
Praise you, Father. Thank you, Father. Praise you, Father. Thank you, Lord.
You know what I love about this time of worship? You know, this time of worshiping with tithes and offerings, it reminds us of something. You know, we've learned, maybe we've known this for a long time, but we've been working through this the past few weeks. But our tithe is our first fruits. We should always give God our first. You know what I mean? But our first in everything. He should be our first love. He should be the first thing that we prioritize in the morning. You know, maybe it's through a time of prayer, just a time of just studying the Word, just starting our day off. You know, He should be our first in all things. If we make Him priority and we give Him our first fruits, it expresses our faith and our trust in Him. It's like, we trust you, God. We trust you, God, with everything that we have. We trust you, Lord, with our marriage, our relationships, with our kids. Lord, we give them to you. Lord, we make you priority. Father, I just pray that would take place in our lives. The things that we think that we can control and hold on to, Lord, I pray, Father, that we can just let them go. Just let them go. Lord, I'm not talking about being irresponsible, because you call us to be good stewards. But Lord, trusting you with all those things, trusting you with our families, trusting you with our finances, Lord, trusting that our future is secure in you. There's so much uncertainty, and sometimes we feel this uncertainty in our lives. We don't know where we're gonna end up. We don't know what's gonna happen tomorrow. But Lord, if we trust you and we put our faith in you, then we don't have to fear tomorrow, because we know that tomorrow is secure in your hands, that you'll guide and direct and you'll protect. You'll cover us. If we trust you, trust is key. So Lord, this demonstration, as we through faith give our tithes and our offerings, Lord, let this be an expression that we trust you first, that we give you our first fruits. Because we trust you, Lord. Because you are faithful. You're the faithful God. In Jesus' name, amen. Bless you in your tithes and offerings.
I once was dead in sin, alone and hopeless. A child of wrath I walked, condemned in darkness. But your mercy brought new life, and in your loving kindness raised me up with Christ and made me righteous. You have brought me back with the riches of your amazing grace.
Amazing grace. Awesome. We have an awesome God, don't we?
I think we could do a little better than that. We have an awesome God, don't we? Oh, that's much better. Oh, it's good to be in the house of the Lord, isn't it? There's nothing like worshiping together. You know, there's just an electric in the room, excitement in the room. It's just awesome to be here with the family here at Bethel. If you are new here at Bethel or you're viewing online for the first time, we just want to welcome you to Bethel Christian Fellowship. We hope you feel excited about serving the Lord because it's exciting to serve the Lord. Amen. If you are new here, if you can grab one of those communication cards right in front of you in the back of the seats and fill that out, we would love a record of your visit. And as always, we promise not to send any junk mail. Or how many of you get those phone calls on your cell phones now? You know, those they're trying to sell something to you. Very annoying. I promise you, we will not do that. But we want a record of your visit. And if you decide to make this your home, that is a way that we have your information and we can connect you to classes and events and small groups that we have here at Bethel. But let's just give our new folks a round of applause. Great to have you here this morning. A couple of announcements before I have Michael come up. Many of you remember the socks that we are filling up for our military people. Well, there's a military festival of food after service. You're going to enjoy a bowl of soup for a dollar in the body shop after service. The body shop is the building across Anson Place, and it says body shop on it. And you actually go there, and you can have a bowl of soup, and they're actually going to pack those packages today to send off to our military folks. Also, in your bulletin, and always in the bulletin, are the details that we don't actually give you up here. We just give you general information, but if you look in the bulletin, there's details. And about halfway down on the front of the page, there's a pizza party for Bethel Young Adults. That's going to be December 13th in room 306. And again, it's that way, and you kind of follow the signs. You go in our administration building up to the top floor. But there's a pizza party after service with the young adults, and they're asking you to bring a game and a friend and free food. Free. Do you love that word? Free. I love free. It's good. Michael, where are you, Michael? What side are you on? You're not even really on a side. Get over here. It's great to have Michael with B with us this morning. They're going to bless us in song in a minute, but before that, Michael has a couple things he wants to share with you.
Good morning. How's everyone doing? Good. Merry Christmas. Well, we can still get away with it. In fact, I'll get away with it when we can't get away with it. Merry Christmas. Bethel Express, for those of you who do not know, is the urban outreach ministry that has its origin right here at Bethel Christian Fellowship. We call ourselves raising up champions in society by way of what we call the S factor, which is in this order priority: spiritual strength, social stability, and scholastic success. And we call our children, or our kids, well, they grow up on us, but we call them children of Rochester's Children of God's Promise. And we are determined to make sure that they become productive citizens in our society by way of the S factor. And many of you have been supporting us over the years, and we are grateful to you for that. So thank you very much for that. Every year at this time, we are given the privilege, the opportunity, and the blessing to appeal to you to support our children for our annual Christmas mall trip. And this year will take place Saturday, December 19th. And the sponsorship for each of the children will be $50. And what we do with that is the children are able to go shopping. Many of them, of course, shop for themselves, but for the most part, they shop for their loved ones, their relatives, their parents. Some of the children who come from the same household, actually, they pool their money together to buy a really nice gift for their mother. And so we know that it's not just about receiving, and they know that too. It's not just about receiving, but also about being selfless and giving selflessly for other people. And if you're interested in sponsoring any of the children, you may do so in the back after the service is over, and you will gain access to a name of a child. Actually, I have one right here. This is Suli, and she's fairly new to our ministry, but it seems like she's been with us forever, and she's a real blessing. In case someone would like this one, you may have this one, but you may gain access to any of the names of any of the children. You'll receive a picture, their name, and information about them. And lastly, it's always good to be able to give people good memories. And we know for many of our children, not necessarily all of them, but for most of them, this is the best portion of Christmas for them, and we desire to give them the best memories and the memories of a lifetime, if you will. And so if you're able to and you're willing to do so, we welcome you to support our children. And once again, we thank you so much for supporting us as a ministry. God is doing amazing things. Well, he's God. Of course he does amazing things. But you know what I mean. I want to say it publicly. God is doing amazing things. So God bless you. Thank you for your support, and Merry Christmas.
Thank you, Michael. The BE band can come up here. We mentioned last week that this is the week that we take our missions offering, and obviously Bethel Express is one of those local ministries that we support. And we have specific prayer requests. If you look in your bulletins, you'll have those weekly. We covet your prayers. It's important that you pray for these ministries and the missionaries, not just financially supporting them, but praying for them, because we know that prayer changes things. It's important that we become a praying people. Amen? We need to become a praying people. This is how the church does warfare. We do it in the spiritual realm. So please continue to pray for them. But often there's going to be some practical needs that are listed there, and you'll have an opportunity to pray, but also to give financially. And I just want to mention a few that we're emphasizing. Leslie Latona, we took a group of people. How many people did we have with us in Columbia this year? What, 15? Oh yeah, about 15, 16. And it was just an awesome trip. You heard the testimonies, but we're praying for Leslie Latona in Colombia, and also the ministry that she's connected with, Suba, and they're starting home groups. So we just want to pray that they raise up good leaders. And I tell you, they have an incredible discipleship program. They're not going to have a problem raising up good leaders. But we just want to pray that's a great success. We're emphasizing, hallelujah, military missions, the Festival of Food, which is happening today in the Body Shop right after service. And also, Christians United for Israel. If you've been at Bethel for any period of time, you know that we love Israel. And there are Israel's in our hearts. We're often praying for Israel. Not just Jewish people in Israel, but everybody who resides in Israel. Everybody knows in the Middle East that the safest place to be in the Middle East, no matter what religion you practice, is actually in Israel. So just keep Israel in your prayers for the protection of the people of Israel in the peace of Jerusalem. And then, of course, Bethel Express. And are they up here? Where are they? Come on. Praying for 30-plus regular BE kids attending faithfully and healings and breakthroughs. I mean, you can make a deposit in somebody's life just meeting them once. But if they have these kids faithfully coming every week to BE, there's an opportunity for them to be fathered and mothered properly, spiritually, and to raise them up to be disciples. So the longer they're with BE, the more successful they're going to be. So they just want 30-plus regular BE kids attending. And so if you could just keep those things in your prayer. Father, we're gonna agree together. Lord, we just like prayers rising up as an aroma, like incense to the heavens, Father. Lord, we pray that our prayers would rise up to the heavens and that you would do war for us, Lord. Lord, that you would cause these things to come and pass. Lord, I believe that you want us to pray specific things and specific prayers. So, Lord, we're praying for these specific things, these specific needs. Lord, that you would just network the right people to connect with these ministries, that you would pour in the financial funds to make these ministries successful, that you would put it on the hearts of the people just to continue to pray for these things, pray for these peoples, pray for these needs. Lord, that these ministries would be successful and they would bear much fruit. Father, we don't want small baskets of fruit. We want big baskets of fruit. And we just thank you, Father. We praise you, Lord, because you're going to accomplish this work through our faithfulness. And we just praise you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Okay, come on up. We would like to do something real quick before we do this song. For the sake of time, I'm going to...
I thought you were God. on, but Debbie's not feeling well, so remember in your prayer. I'm going to say this in order of time. Come, Debbie. We had this for you in April, but I've been blessed to work with such tremendous people when I was part of staff here at Bethel. And they still continue to support us in so many ways, and Debbie Anderson is one of this. And it says, presented to Debbie Anderson for Christ-like servitude and commitment in helping children become champions in society. Debbie worked so many hours, and she worked so many hours. She was supposed to play drums today, but things changed. I just want to let you know how much we love you. We wanted to recognize you and tell you thank you for all you do. She also runs our Chris Soderstrom's children's ministry clothing closet. Her and Bob helps with cooking, so we're so grateful to you. And I just like to, we have a board member that's leaving, moving to California, 5 months with her son, and then 7 months with her daughter. She's relocating from Rochester. We would dearly miss her. She is a Bethelite. And Joyce White Johnson, would you please stand? Those of you that know her, wish her well as she's going to go release full-time the ministry. We love you.
Won the victory. So, I'm sure by now you've heard something different is going on here at Bethel during the holidays. Advent community's in full force. I can't wait to hear the stories of the different gatherings that are happening throughout the season. Remember, Advent community is about gathering, giving, and going. So let's take the next step, which is giving. We're about to give thanks in a different way. What we need you to do is help us give to families and neighborhoods that are in real need. We've already organized a Christmas morning food bag that we'll be giving to families, but we don't think that's enough. We would like you to go out and buy $15 Walmart gift cards. Starting today also, you have the chance to purchase the gift cards from our church office or during our Sunday celebrations. Then you can wrap that one gift card up in a shoebox or a smaller box and place it on the stage on any Sunday morning before Christmas. Now, if you're not good at wrapping like me, let us do the wrapping for you. Then we'll be all set to bless our community on Christmas morning. That's right. Don't forget that we're going out to spread the cheer on Christmas morning. Stay tuned for more on that. So we're gathering, we're giving, and then we're going to go and share God's love. I'm excited, and I hope you are too. Go to our new website, BethelRock.com, for more information. Advent community, it's all about Jesus. It's all about people. Let's celebrate it together.
That great video. Can you believe Thanksgiving is over? How many would say yes? How many would say no? How many of you had turkey for breakfast this morning? Tempting? Christmas is now in full swing. We're starting to see trees on the top of cars, lights in people's yards, towns are hanging their bells and their snowflakes and things like that all over the telephone poles. Christmas music is playing and has been playing for some time in just about every store that you go into. We're busy holiday planning, Christmas parties at work, haircut appointments, right? Maybe nail appointments, shopping lists, and the list goes on and on and on. And as this video showed you, we've been pretty busy around here with getting geared up for Christmas as well with our Advent community initiative. That's in full swing. We've had very good response in reference to the gatherings. How many of you have been or plan on getting together with some other people from the congregation from Bethel to just kind of connect and have some food and fellowship and fun and things like that? In reference to the young adults and the pizza party that's coming up in a couple weeks, mentioning gatherings, you can go back to one of the tables after the service over in this corner on East Avenue and you can sign up so we know how much pizza to get for you, okay? We kicked off our giving campaign last week. You're going to have another opportunity at the end of the service today. Bethel Express was mentioned. They're going to be back there at a table. We encourage you to jump in and just kind of help. It's always a great time of year for these kids and for their families, and it's a blessing to be able to be a part of that. So that's one opportunity that you'll have to give in the back. In addition to that, we sold, I think, $25, $15 Walmart gift cards last week and a number of food bags that we're going to be gathering together, that you guys are helping us put together, and then we're going to be going out Christmas morning into the community and hand those things out. How many of you, just by a show of hands, we're going to do a sign-up, but we're not going to have it today. How many of you think you might join us for Christmas morning for a couple of hours? Hold your hands up nice and high. We just want to get an idea. Lots of people. Awesome. It's going to be great. This isn't a guilt trip. You can participate in this by getting food bags and Walmart cards and sponsoring BE kids and things like that. You don't have to go Christmas morning, but we're glad to see that a number of you are going to. I want to give you a definition right before we get into this message. It's a definition of the word Advent. Advent, and there's quite a few definitions out there, but there's one on your screen that is pretty consistent with all of them that I've read. It's basically the period beginning 4 Sundays before Christmas. Today is the fourth Sunday. It's the first Sunday of 4 that we're going to have before Christmas. It's the period, I should just read, right, and not elaborate? Elaborating gets me into trouble. The period beginning 4 Sundays before Christmas and observed by some Christians, not by all Christians, by many Christians, as a celebration of the birth and the coming of Jesus Christ. And due to the fact that we've had this Advent community focus, and this initiative and things like that, we thought, well, I don't know that we've really done this before. We've done a lot of messages leading up to Christmas, but we wanted to be very intentional and take the four Sundays leading up to Christmas, today being the first one, and focus on the topics that Advent typically focuses on. And they are hope and love and joy and peace, not necessarily in that order. Okay? I'm going to ask you to join me in prayer. I'm glad that today is Sunday, and I'm glad I have an opportunity to speak, because every time I look at my notes, I mark them up more and more and more, and I'm afraid that if I mark them up anymore, I'm not going to be able to make sense of it. So let's pray together. Father God, we thank you for this season. We thank you so much for sending your Son into this world and to us to give us hope, to give us love, to give us joy, to give us peace. You know, and we know, that we could all use more of that in the days and the times that we live in. So God, I pray that you would, as you have already, just be present. We invite you to be here in the sanctuary this morning. We invite you to be in our hearts. And Father God, we just pray that you would soften our hearts to receive whatever it is that you would have us to receive, God, that you would help me to say exactly what you would have me to, help me to be quiet where I need to, and that, Lord God, you would help each and every one of us, just give each and every one of us a deposit that would be something that would be able to help us walk out these doors today, make a difference and an impact, and give us new hope in our own lives, and that's not just for the benefit of ourselves and our family, but the benefit of everyone that we come into contact with, and we thank you for it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Okay, I'm going to try to get you to be a little interactive today. Is that cool? Okay, about four of you. Great. I'm going to try. The less you participate, the harder time that you give me, the longer I'm going to take, because I'm going to have to repeat questions. Okay? So you're with me, right? You're going to help out a little bit? Okay. I won't take that personal. I know that you just did that because you want to get out of here a little sooner, but what time do the Bills play today? 1 o'clock? They're playing the Chiefs, right? I hope the Bills beat the Chiefs. Can you believe I said that? I do. Buffalo's not my least favorite team in the world. Okay. Anyway, how many of you have ever seen the movie It's a Wonderful Life? How many have already seen it this year? How many of you have seen it more than once this year? If you've never seen It's a Wonderful Life, you should check it out. You should watch it. This is a movie about a man whose name is George Bailey. He had big plans for his life. He wanted to travel the world. He wanted to be an architect. His younger brother went off to the military, and just all kinds of things happened. And he felt like he was stuck. I don't even remember the town that he was in. But anyway, he felt that he was stuck and wasn't going to be able to pursue the plans and the dreams that he had for his own life because of all of the other things that were going on. He felt like he had to take over the savings and loan bank because his younger brother surprised everybody, went off to the military, and his father had died. He felt like, I got to carry this and I got to do this. So he really, really struggled with where he was at. There was one scene in this movie. I wanted to show you a clip, but I decided that I wasn't going to. If you're mad at me, that's okay. You can watch the movie yourself. There was one scene in the movie, just before he was going to go to the bridge and basically jump off and commit suicide. He was at the end of his rope. He was done with it all. And he slowly raised his head and he pleaded and said, God, God, dear Father in heaven, I'm not a praying man, but if you're up there and you can hear me, then show me the way. I'm at the end of my rope. Show me the way, God. Show me the way. Now, Jimmy Stewart, who played George Bailey in this film, said that something happened to him when he was filming this movie that had never happened to him before. And I quote, Jimmy Stewart said, as I spoke these words, I felt loneliness, the hopelessness of people everywhere who had nowhere to turn, and my eyes filled with tears. I broke down sobbing. It was something that wasn't planned at all. But the power of that prayer, the realization that our Father in heaven is there to help the hopeless, had reduced me to tears. We all know that actors and actresses are taught to take on the role of the person that they are portraying. But he had no idea that he was going to respond to this scene the way that he did. Proverbs 13:12 says that hope deferred makes the heart sick. George Bailey was sick because he was losing hope. The Message translation for that scripture says that unrelenting disappointment leaves you heart sick. There was plenty of disappointment in his life, and he almost decided to jump off of a bridge and put an end to it all. And I know you might say, well, that's just in the movies. But how many of you know anyone that came to the end of their rope and gave up and committed suicide? It happens in real life many, many times every single day. Why? Because they don't have hope. They lose hope. Chuck Swindoll said it this way, hope is as important to us as water is to a fish, as vital as electricity to a light bulb, as essential as air to a jumbo jet. Hope is basic to life. Without it, we are doomed to a dark and a grim existence. Hope is a vital necessity of life. I hope. You with me? Okay. How many of you would say, I hope that the Bills beat the Chiefs today? I pray that the Bills beat the Chiefs today. How many of you would say that I hope that the Giants beat the Redskins? Oh, we got more Giants fans than Bills fans in here? No, they're just louder. Maybe they have reason to be, I don't know. I hope it doesn't rain tomorrow. I hope I get a dog or an iPod or a PS4 or a new car or a new kitchen table for Christmas. The problem with hope as we use it today is that it really isn't much more than wishful thinking or unsure optimism. I mean, if you think about it, I hope the Bills win today, and they might, but there's a good chance that they won't. I hope it doesn't rain tomorrow. Chances are it's not spring, it's fall, moving into winter. Chances are it's not going to rain tomorrow. But if you have any outdoor plans, it might be wise to check the weather forecast first because you never know. It could rain tomorrow. You might hope that it doesn't, but it could, right? I hope that I get a dog for Christmas. How many of you are hoping you get a dog? Well, then you better hope that you get an automatic pooper scooper too, because, and you might say, no, I have kids. Well, that's not all that automatic. We can hope for something all that we want, and all indications may be that it will come true. But how many of you would agree that life is pretty unpredictable? And really, you never really know what's going to happen. So what's the good news? In Scripture, the Hebrew and the Greek words, and there's quite a few of them. I don't know, there's probably 10 or so of them in the Hebrew. And then in the Greek, there's a couple of them. And there's various definitions. But the general consensus is that those words' meaning of the word hope is something that will certainly happen. When hope was used in the Bible, regardless of whether it was in the Old Testament or the New Testament, it was a strong and a confident expectation that had existed. It wasn't a wishy-washy maybe. It wasn't a flip of a coin. It was a confident, absolutely, it is certainly going to happen. And you can read all through Scripture where hope is mentioned, especially in the Old Testament. And then you look a little bit later in the Old Testament, or you look at how God did things in the New Testament and prophecy was fulfilled. The hope in the Bible is much different than the way that we use hope today. How many of you would agree with that? So this was the kind of hope that motivated the Magi, or the wise men, of the nativity story in Matthew 2 to embark on a dangerous 1,000-mile journey that propelled them to give of their treasures, that prompted them to risk their own safety on roads that were littered with dangerous people. This was the kind of hope that motivated them to take a chance, but they really weren't taking a whole lot of a chance, because they knew that God had promised. And when God promises something, then it's going to happen. And I don't know about you, but I wouldn't have embarked on a trip like that on a hunch. It wasn't a hunch. It wasn't a coin toss for them. They knew what hope meant. They knew what they had learned by studying the scriptures. And I'm getting ahead of myself, so I'm getting back to my notes. There was plenty that we do not know for certain about these wise men. But it's very likely that they were from, and there's differing opinions, but the majority of people and Bible scholars would say that they were from ancient Babylon. They could have been Jews that remained in Babylon after the exile. You remember that Daniel was taken, and his friends were taken, and a number of people were taken into Babylon and held into captivity. And basically, Daniel and his three friends basically were wise men. They were magi. They likely had and studied copies of the Old Testament. They may have had a special message or a dream from God regarding Jesus' birth. They no doubt were indirectly influenced generation after generation by Daniel and his Jewish friends. But one thing is for certain. The Magi were alert, and they were looking forward to the coming of the King of the Jews, because God had promised that, and that was good enough for them. So they were just waiting for it to happen. You can read Daniel chapter 9, and I encourage you, if you're going to read Daniel chapter 9, you kind of got to get into a study Bible. You kind of got to get into the original meanings of words and things like this, because I started to do it, and I got a little bit confused, and I have a confession to make. I haven't arrived there yet. I've got to go back, and I'm not ready to present it to you. What I do know is this. Daniel 9 spoke of the timing of the birth of Jesus Christ, and it was very, very accurate. So I encourage you to study Daniel chapter 9. Micah 5, verses 2 to 4 is a passage of Scripture that we're going to read together. If you have your Bibles, you can open, or it'll be up on the screen. In Micah chapter 5, this passage of Scripture spoke of the location of the coming, or the birth of the Messiah. Verses 2 to 4, and it says, "But you, O Bethlehem, are only a small village among the people of Judah, yet a ruler of Israel, whose origins are in the distant past, will come from you on my behalf. The people of Israel will be abandoned to their enemies until the woman in labor gives birth. Then at last his fellow countrymen will return from exile to their own land. And he will stand to lead his flock with the Lord's strength in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. Then his people will live there undisturbed, for he will be highly honored around the world." So both those passages in Daniel and in Micah speak to the timing and the place of the Messiah's birth. The wise men most definitely had access to this information, but no doubt the religious leaders that lived in Israel did as well. Yet they didn't act on it. Same information, right? The wise men, how many of you would agree that the wise men and the Jewish religious leaders who lived in Israel probably had the same information? But there was a very different result. Why? Because of the condition of the heart. And this is key. The Savior of the world was born right under the noses of the religious leaders, and they didn't even know it. While there were wise men who lived 1,000 miles away, who were packing their bags for a very long, a very dangerous, and a very expensive trip, with full anticipation of seeing their Messiah face to face. And I'm going to step out on a limb here this morning, and I'm going to venture to guess that there will be some of you that might grab hold of something that the Lord gives you this morning, and it might renew your hope a little bit. But there are probably others of you that are here this morning that might be rolling your eyes and might not be agreeing with what I'm speaking this morning. And that's your prerogative. But I want to challenge you not to throw Jesus out of the equation too quickly. I'm going to say it again. I want to challenge you not to throw up the wall and just be open to hear and allow the Lord to speak to you. Don't throw him out too quickly. Biblical hope finds soil in a seeking heart. People usually find what they are looking for. The Lord's track record is a lot better than yours. And it's a lot better than mine. So I implore you, I challenge you, I encourage you. Just stay open. Don't think that you have it all together. And allow the Lord to speak to you this morning. Not me, but the Lord. There are plenty of other people in the Bible who found their hope in God, and I'm only going to mention a few. And these are people that it didn't usually happen overnight. It certainly wasn't easy, but in the end, God came through for them. King David, the greatest worshiping warrior of Israel, experienced hope deferred during a time when he was being falsely accused of disloyalty. He had to flee for his life, and he had to hide in caves. And in Psalms chapters 42 and 43, David, a man after God's own heart, actually had to command his soul to hope three times. He was at the end of his rope. He didn't know how he was going to get out of it, but God. He had to command his soul to hope three times in two chapters in Psalms. The woman with the issue of blood in Mark chapter 5, verses 25 to 27. For 12 years, this woman struggled with her blood issue. She had spent all that she had, the scriptures say, to go to doctors to try to find a solution, only to get worse. There was a social stigma with people that had issues like this. They couldn't be around people. They couldn't be too close to people. They couldn't touch people. But she refused to give up hope. It didn't matter how weak she was, what law she was going to break, or who or how many people she was going to have to push out of the way. She scratched and she clawed at the ground and she pushed people out of the way just to touch the hem of Jesus' robe. Because she had tried everything else and nothing worked. Actually, it got worse. She didn't care what law she was going to break, who she was going to have to touch, who she was going to have to push out of the way. She was going to touch the hem of Jesus' garment. Abraham and Sarah had an extreme case of hope deferred. Actually, in Romans chapter 4:18, it says that they had to hope against all hope. In the face of absolute hopelessness, Abraham hoped anyway. Abraham and Sarah, God had spoken to them 24 years before that they were going to have a child. Sarah was barren. She wasn't able to have kids. And God comes to them one last time, promising a son to them. And in Genesis chapter 17 and in Genesis chapter 18, it says that Abraham actually fell at his face and laughed. Have any of you laughed at God? Have any of you read a scripture and just kind of, there's absolutely no way that's not going to happen in my life? Yeah, it's for you. No. Can't be. It's not going to happen. Scriptures say that Abraham actually fell on his face and laughed and said in his heart, will a child be born to a man who is 100 years old? And his wife Sarah did the same thing because she was 90. Okay, I'm getting ready to close, but I want to show you a video clip. But before I do, I have a feeling that you're going to be lost if I don't intro it. Okay? This is a movie that I stumbled on. It's a short film called The Butterfly Circus. And this is a little introduction. It says, at the height of the Great Depression, the showman of a renowned circus was leading his troupe through the devastated American landscape with a goal of putting a smile on people's faces and lifting their spirits. During their travels, they discover Will, who in this film is played by Nick Vujicic. How many of you know who he is? He's a man who was born without any limbs. He didn't have any legs, didn't have any arms. So they're traveling around, and they discover this man by the name of Will at a carnival slideshow. But after an intriguing and challenging encounter with the showman, Will becomes driven to hope against everything that he has ever believed. So we're going to roll the clip, and I want to encourage you to look it up and watch the whole thing. The whole thing is 20 minutes long. I didn't want to take the time, but it's a very powerful film. Go ahead.
Ladies and gentlemen, girls and boys, what this world needs is a little wonder. Isn't it? The way they move, full of strength, color, and grace. They're astounding.
But you?
Cursed from birth. A man, if you can call him that, who God himself turned his back upon.
Stop it! Why would you say that?
Because you believe it. But if you could only see the beauty that can come from ashes.
Problem now. You're no good to me, so get out.
You're good enough for me, Dollface. Here you go.
But they're different from me.
Yes, you do have an advantage. The greater the struggle, the more glorious the triumph.
Sometimes life isn't fair, is it? Nor is it necessarily easy. Life can throw us curveballs quite often. It can be very challenging, especially at this time of year. It's a very fun time of year for some, but it's a very challenging time of year for others. Maybe you've lost a loved one, and it's just holidays aren't quite the same. Or maybe you've had a marriage that's failed or is failing. Or maybe you're tired of waiting for one to happen. Maybe you've had a business that went under within the last year You've had a bad doctor's visit. Or you have a family member that still hasn't accepted Christ as Lord and Savior. Maybe you have a stressed relationship with one or all of your kids. Maybe you're not able to have children, or so you've been told. Maybe you're in a financial mess. The list goes on and on and on. And if I haven't mentioned the thing that that you really need hope for, that you're struggling with this holiday season, this Christmas season, then you can fill in the blank. But the Bible says that Jesus came to give hope to the world. It is the whole reason that God gave his Son, to give us hope, to give us love, to give us joy, to give us peace. Psalm 147:3 says that he heals the brokenhearted and he bandages their wounds. That's not a wishy-washy statement. That's an emphatic statement. Philippians 1:6 says that I am certain that God who began a good work within you will continue his work until it's finally finished on the day when Christ returns. Romans 8:37 says, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Isaiah 40:31 says that those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and they will not grow weary. They will walk and they will not faint. Hebrews 6, verses 18 and 19. This is a huge scripture. Says this, these two things cannot change. God cannot lie when he says something, and he cannot lie when he makes an oath. So these two things are a great help to us who have come to God for safety. They encourage us to hold on to hope that is ours. This hope is like an anchor for us. And I thought it was so neat that one of the songs that we sang earlier was about hope being an anchor. This hope is like an anchor for us. It is strong and sure, and it keeps us safe. Biblical hope, the kind where we can expect with confidence, finds soil in a seeking heart. People usually do find what they are looking for. My question to you this morning is, what is it that you're looking for? And where are you looking for it? Jeremiah 29, 12 and 13 say that when you call on the name of God, you will come to me and you will pray to me and I will listen to you. You will search for me when you search for me with all of your heart and you will find me. This Advent season, we come together to celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ, which brought hope into the world. And we also look forward to the second coming of Jesus Christ. But in the meantime, we all have roller coasters in our lives. We all have ups. We all have downs. We all have high times. We all have low times. The only thing that can give you and I what we need when we're really, really struggling is Jesus Christ. Hope finds its soil in a seeking heart. Where are you looking? The only correct answer in that, and it doesn't mean that God can't use doctors, it doesn't mean that God can't use scripture, God can't use people. Jesus is the one that we need to hope in. I don't know if you've I know that there's people in this room that are really, really struggling. The holidays are a very challenging time. Thanksgiving, Christmas, New Year's. Like I said, they can be very exciting. They can be very fun. They can be great, but they can also be very hard because of situations that some of us find ourselves in. I want to encourage you to hope in Jesus. And, you know, my sense is there might be some that are here this morning that can't do that because you don't have a relationship with him. So I want to take a few minutes this morning, because that's what it all starts with. It all starts with a relationship. It all starts with you saying, God, I'm tired. I'm at the end of my rope. I thank you for the people that you've put in my life that helped me to walk from one day to the next, but they're not enough, and I need you. Maybe there's some people here this morning, and I'm not trying to twist anybody's arms, but I can tell you this, without putting a faith and a trust and a confidence in Jesus Christ, you will always come up short. Every one of us will. So I want to encourage you. I'm going to have everybody just bow your heads and close your eyes and just pray. And I want to encourage you, if you've never, the Lord has just kind of moved on your heart this morning, and you know that holidays can be tough, or maybe they're not, but you still feel God speaking to you this morning, and you've never made a commitment to Christ. This isn't about me. This is about God. This is about you. This is about Jesus Christ. If you've never done that and you want to accept Christ as your Lord and Savior, you want to declare that you want to give him control and reign over your life, I want you to stand up and I want you to come forward. I'm not going to cram a microphone in your face. I'm not going to make you speak publicly. I just want you to come forward and we're going to pray with you. And we're not going to take a long time, but I'm going to give you a minute or two as the worship team just plays. Everybody can keep your heads down, your eyes closed, and just pray. Praise you, God. The Lord wants this for you. He's not a respecter of persons. What the Lord did for this woman with the issue of blood, what the Lord did for Abraham and Sarah, what the Lord did for King David, he'll do for you. Angels are rejoicing right now. Amen. I'm going to give you another 20 seconds. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Ask everyone in here to repeat after me. Those that are standing up front and those that are seated at your seats, I'm just going to ask you to speak this aloud after me and repeat, okay? Father God, I love you. And I thank you for sending your son to die for my sins. Lord, I declare this morning that I need you, that I want you to be the Lord and Savior of my life, that I want you to lead me, guide me, direct me, encourage me, give me hope, and surround me with people that would encourage me to develop my relationship with you. I accept you as Lord and Savior of my life. And I thank you for what you're going to do. I look forward with confident expectation for what you're going to do in my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Now listen, this is for everybody. The Lord God gave the wise men a what to follow. He put a star in the sky. It didn't actually move in front of them, but it appeared over Bethlehem, and they knew it was time to go. And they also knew to expect the coming of Christ because of the scriptures. And this is for me as well as it is for you. None of us have arrived. How many of you have ever read a scripture 5, 6, 7 times before, and then all of a sudden you read it for the next time, and it just, the light bulb goes on, and it's just, the Lord just revealed something to you that you've never, God is so big, we can't even begin to wrap our heads and our minds and our hearts around it. But that doesn't mean that we stay away, because everything in the Word of God has been inspired by Him. It's our roadmap. It is the thing that we can get into, that we can dig into, that we can read, that we can study. And as we do, there can be some very confusing things. I mean, I read through the Old Testament, and I'm like, really, God? You know, we need to pray and ask the Holy Spirit to help us to understand things. And if people ask you questions about your beliefs or about the Word, and you don't have a good answer for them, it's okay to say, you know what, I'm not really sure, but I'm going to dig into that. Same thing as I got up in front of you and said, Daniel 9. You know, it talks about the timing to the day, 483 days, that Jesus Christ was going to be born. I got to get my head around that. I got to get into it a little bit more. But I want to encourage everyone in this sanctuary this morning, myself included, we've got to continue to stay in the Word of God. Because, you know, we watch the news, we get on the computer and watch the news, we hear things, we talk to friends about all of this stuff that's going on in Paris and all over the world, and it begins to suck us down, and it begins to drag us down. We begin to lose hope deferred, and we kind of start that slippery slope. The Bible is what we need to be able to encourage us to build up our lives, amen? So I want to encourage you to do that. Those of you that are up here this morning, welcome to the family of God. The Lord has big plans. The three of you that are writing up here, listen to me 1 second. I don't care where you've been. You make me cry, Kathy. Or what you've been through. Jesus Christ has big plans for the three of you. Amen. Amen. So as we close the service, you know, maybe you don't need to accept Christ because you have when you were 7 years old or last year or whatever. But you have this situation that you're struggling with that you just feel like you're kind of at the end of your rope. And if that's you and you would like some other believers, some people that have kind of been there and done that, you don't have to spill your guts. If you want to share, you can. But you know what? God is big enough. He knows what you're going through. You don't have to share anything with anybody if you don't want to. But if you just want prayer, I'm going to release everybody, but if you want prayer, don't leave this place without allowing someone to have an opportunity just to speak over you, to declare God's life over you, to speak a scripture to you, to lay their hands on you and pray for you. So if that's you, I want you to come forward, and I'm going to have the ministry team come up, and we'll spend some time in prayer. The rest of you, in a second, after David says something, we'll be free to go.
Just real quick, hope takes action. It takes movement. It's not just a change of thinking. So whatever you're hoping for, then it should be followed up by an action, a new commitment. You know, if it's hope for a relationship problem that you've been having, you're hoping that God restores it, it requires an action from you. You have to choose to love. You know, you have to choose to make the next step. So whatever that thing is, you know, they had to come up front, because hope requires an action. It requires movement. And then The follow-up process to this is, what does it mean to be a follower of Christ? So we're going to help them. We're going to disciple them. We're going to show them what it means to live the Christian life. So whatever you're hoping for, you got to make that, you got to take that action. Take that next step. Amen? God bless you all.
Is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but only trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ Savior's love through the storm. He is born, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on faultless stand before the throne.